Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Brookfield Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, July 12th. Ask everyone to please arise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to ask everyone to please remain standing. Unfortunately, the flag, if we drive around not only this town, but all 351 towns and cities in the Commonwealth, we see the flags at a perpetual half-mast. It's saddening. It has a heavy weight on my soul. We don't do a lot of moment of silences for all of those tragedies, but I really feel it's fitting for today, especially with the memorial down in Dallas for the five men that gave their lives to protect the people of Dallas, and I'm going to even perpetuate even more the good of the entire nation. This is a great nation. We live in the best country in the world, and I'm honored to have men and women not only in Dallas but Brookfield that serve us, that put on uniforms, walk out the door, kiss their family goodbye, not knowing if they're ever going to come home. Not just our town, but the other 350, our state troopers, everybody that's involved in letting us enjoy our lives. So I'd ask everyone to please observe a moment of silence for the five men. Thank you. And thank you again to the men and women that serve us. I will entertain a motion to approve the warrant for, we're going to ratify all four of the payroll warrants for 6:30, another payroll warrant for 6:30, two expense warrants for 6:30.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Entertain a motion to acknowledge the Conservation Commission's report for 216, 419, 516, Memorial Committee for 54, Advisory Committee for 314, 317, 328, Fire Department monthly report for June, and EMS monthly report for June.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Mm-hmm. Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Announcements, Mr. Wallinan, District 8 to Senator Ann Gobey will be holding office hours at Brookfield Town Hall from 10:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Wednesday, July 20th. All are welcome. Volunteers, ladies and gentlemen, we talk about this every single time that we sit here. You are needed. You're needed to serve on several town committees, including the Advisory Committee, Local Public Access Committee, Conservation Committee. A letter of interest should be submitted to the Board of Selectmen, 6 Central Street, Brookfield, Mass., or email selectmen@brookfieldma.us. I had asked to group all of these into one, and we will forward your interest to the appropriate committees. Anybody have any other announcements? Public access, anybody wish to address the board this evening? Welcome, sir.
Evening.
Good evening.
Yeah, based on what you said there, Steve, I think we in our town, we got a great little town here, and I do appreciate everything that we have in this town. So I think we're all trying to improve it in many ways.
Mm-hmm.
We talked at the advisory board last night about getting another bid on the insurance, and I talked to Karen, and she said we can't get another bid until we need smoke alarms in here, and you brought that up a year ago.
Well, the smoke alarms were for a bid through another company specifically. It had nothing to do with going out to bid for other companies. It was just for one.
Okay, but are we still going to get smoke alarms in the building?
Mr. Mansfield's been contacted again, and he's going to put a plan together. It would have to be approved by the fire chief, and he's going to do that in September.
Is it going to like ring outside or have a
that'll be kind of
a light system?
That'll be the plan that Mr. Mansfield and Chief Martell approved.
So you're working on it then?
Correct.
Yes.
Okay.
He was contacted last week, I believe.
Yes, and he said as soon as the kids go back to school, he will map out a plan.
Okay. What are we doing with the tree, having a tree guy? Did you get a hold of
it's on
Ken Chabot?
It's on the agenda. I spoke with Mr. Stendrup last week. He had viewed the tree, the limb that came down by your property. I had asked him to reach out to you, actually. Did he ever reach out to you?
Yeah, he wanted to get some contractors, and I gave him the one that he was already going to call. So.
And we have one estimate in our packet that we're going to go over tonight.
Is that just for one job, or is it going to be...
It's by the hour. It'll be at the discretion of the tree warden to basically...
Oh, it's going to be kind of like the last...
It's always at the discretion...
In conjunction with the other guy that used to, that does it too?
But we've worked in tangent to save the town money, but the tree warden's always responsible for it because he always has to sign off on the warrants to get people paid.
Right.
So...
So you're gonna,
I didn't ask for any of the estimates. That was just brought to me.
I asked him to go out to several people.
Are we going to talk about that later?
It's under correspondence.
Oh, I just want to know where it was going, that's all.
Yeah, okay. I had some thoughts.
Yeah.
What about the one other thing, the procedure on going out with the highway department and all the trucks and the manpower and then coming back from... Did you follow up? You said you were going to follow up on that.
No, on that topic, no.
So where's it stand right now? I mean, how's the procedure going to go forward?
I'd say standoff, because the highway superintendent has his routines, and you have an opinion, and it's up to him.
No, it's not an opinion. It's a practice of what is taking place. It's not an opinion. It's a practice, and I was bringing it forward to you that practice is costing a lot of money. So I'm asking you if you're going to change that practice, or is he going to change that practice?
Not to my knowledge, nor did I ask him to, or even think about it.
Okay, so the whole crew and all the trucks are going to come back to the garage for a 15-minute break, and then they're all going to truck back out again. And then an hour and a half later, they're all going to truck back for lunch.
So, Clarence, so we don't get muddied down and bogged down in this, can you just reach out to the highway superintendent and find out if that is standard practice for everything, for every job, 15 minutes coming back to the barn?
I will ask what the standard practice is.
I would agree with Mr. Holcraft that coming back from the other side of town for 15 minutes is not cost effective.
Yeah.
I disagree with that.
My assumption is if it does happen, it doesn't happen every single day.
No.
I think it might be rare occasions. Lunch, I wouldn't put it past them to come to a building to take lunch.
Of course, they have been to lunch.
Exactly.
Break.
But when you talk about 15
minutes. But a break is.
We'll get correspondence from that. And
We will certainly get correspondence for the standard practice.
And you gave me a quote of bringing a portable toilet. You quoted $8.50 for the day.
Oh no.
Heavens no. I must have heard wrong then.
I think we're talking extremes there.
I'm not talking.
I don't know where that number came from. I pay $90 a month David,
okay,
I think you're losing it. But that's
I'm not losing it. I'm going to listen to the tape.
We'll listen to the tape.
Gentlemen, let's stay on topic. Okay. We're not going to put a porta potty on a highway job where they.
No. I understand. I'm just going on what he said. Okay, I'm going to listen.
So it's 90 a month.
That might be better. That's something.
I can't see putting a porta potty on a job.
No. That's not what I said.
He was headed in a direction in the last conversation, and I was headed in a direction.
All right, so
let's disagree.
Let's head back to where Mr. Holcraft's point is. We're good with that. We're going to get back to you.
Okay, that practice, not opinion, on the practice.
What
okay.
is the practice?
Not opinion.
I didn't. Okay. No,
you just said opinion. It's practice.
I said you had an opinion.
No. I'm just what is happening is a practice by the highway, and you said it was my opinion, and it's not my opinion. Yeah. It's something that's taking place. That's a practice.
Okay. So we're gonna look into it, and we'll get back.
Okay. I wanted to clarify.
Next issue.
I wanted to clarify Clarence saying it was an opinion.
Next issue, Dave. Before I get parked somewhere.
I'm going to go back out in the audience.
That was so out of both of you. Let's go.
I'm going to go back out in the audience.
No. Speaking of opinions.
I just did.
I'm looking
that
forward.
That wasn't an opinion, though.
No. So that's it tonight, Dave.
Anybody else? Hang on. You're letting him off scot-free here.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are. He had also a task. If I've forgotten a task, I think he's forgotten a task, because he was going to provide me the study of the time study of the highway admin.
On
the highway admin and the refusal of the 4 hours. You were going to provide me.
Oh, okay, we did. Yeah. No, I would have brought that up to you a minute ago.
Oh, okay, good.
We brought it before the board.
Oh, now?
No. To the advisory board.
Mr. Snyder's request.
Right.
Oh, okay.
We brought it up and we discussed it, and we said we're not going to give you a report because she's working. They are working 100 man hours per month down there.
Okay.
Pushing paper.
Yeah.
And to give another four hours is what you're requesting.
Oh, yeah, that's what she requested, the highway superintendent
requested. That's
right.
So that's another, what, 16 hours?
Yeah, $3,000 a year, yeah.
Well, whatever. And the reason we came up with that is there's two things when we're doing the grants. One is the grant, when you know a grant's coming, you got a good time frame to make sure that grant is put in for.
Yep, we got a couple on the agenda tonight.
So you got to make sure you do the grants that are going to be required to be submitted. You have to make sure those are done first.
Yeah.
The second thing in a grant, you got to make sure it's done accurate.
Yes.
And everything is filled up properly.
And we haven't been unsuccessful in that area?
No, we have.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
So you and I are agreeing on something.
Right.
Yeah, there's two tonight.
And that's not an opinion now, Clarence.
Keep
that's
going.
Fact.
Keep
that's
going.
Because this is the first of the new year. That's
right. So based on those two things, your point is we're losing lots of grants out there. We're losing lots of money.
No.
We're not losing any money. There's plenty. So the board figured there's plenty of hours that are being put into this. And how many hours more do you want to keep putting in?
What?
If we're not losing, we have the paperwork. Now, number three, after grant is done, there's follow-ups. Like on Mill Street, there was follow-up paperwork, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep.
That has to be done until we realize
still open,
that.
You realize that.
Right? Yes, right.
And then, yeah.
But when they're doing the paperwork, they got to do the priorities first, okay? So we don't lose any grants
totally
out there.
Cool with that.
And number four is it's we get awarded 2,000, half a million, 300,000.
Yep.
That isn't that's what this individual does. So, I mean, you're trying to say that if we get X number of dollars, that person should get lots of money. It doesn't work that way.
Well, we will later on the agenda today.
That's the way I took it.
Clarence, can I beat you to the punch?
Go for it.
Is there any possible way that you can, well, maybe before, I don't know if you want to do it now, but before a special town meeting or the next annual town, meet with the advisory committee, lay out the argument?
Well, my argument's still now.
But what's the argument?
You're just with one individual as opposed to the entire board.
Yeah, it should be laid out to the whole committee.
Yeah, but what's your argument? I mean, how many hours do you want to do?
I asked for a simple request of a copy of whatever was decided so I could understand it. I'm hearing now that you have a meeting last week and you talked about what we're doing, and I'm kind of cool with that. But the issue was, did you or did you not do a study? Or some you suggested earlier on the camera that you did a study prior to town meeting, and that study, based on that study, that we shouldn't be doing what we're doing. Now, I've heard your explanation.
Shouldn't be
today.
Doing what we're doing?
The extra hours.
Oh, yeah. Just,
right?
I just explained all that to you.
Yeah, and so where
that's
I'm headed
been,
was,
okay.
I asked, I had done a study,
yeah.
And I provided it to you,
yeah.
And I was asking for yours.
Yeah.
And now what you're saying is you're refusing me a copy of your study.
I just know. The board is said we're not going to do that. We just explained to you.
Was there a study or was just there a conversation for analysis?
It was a conversation and a pretty long discussion.
So you never had a study?
We did a discussion per se and a study per se, but that's...
Yeah. So where I am
So like I said, 100 man hours per month.
I wouldn't disagree
with you. I mean, how many man hours do you want to continue doing?
What I don't want to do... And that's why someone asked you to do this, because Mill Street was not able to be done on time, and we now have at least two, if not three, grant opportunities this evening,
mm-hmm.
where I want to make sure that we have manpower. Now, the other way to approach this thing
mm-hmm.
is that when we talked about it the mm-hmm. last time, that we had consultant monies in the Board of
yep.
Selectmen's hands,
mm-hmm.
and that then I would then turn, because if we have a problem of not being able to get this paperwork in and not be, that we can't get that grant, then would the advisory board support the use of the consultant dollars, because that would be a transfer?
Yeah, I don't think it's the onus of the advisory committee. It's we sign off on a warrant for the grant, right? It's a line item that we
oversee. Clarence, they give you long periods of grant time, just like they give you plenty of time to do grants. What you're saying is you're taking things and you're trying to, you know, making a situation that really doesn't exist. They give you grant periods of time to do something.
Yeah.
It isn't just they call you up, say you get a grant, get it happen in 30 days.
So
that's not the way it works.
A town employee, David, I write a few grants.
Okay.
I have a little practice.
Good. And I have a good knowledge of how the grants are. They just don't call. You just don't call up and say you got 30 days. They give you a long time frame.
We're talking about this building. We're talking a grant cycle that's February next year, if not
right.
a year
and
later.
How much time, when did you get notice on that?
Oh, I got that 6 months ago.
More than that. It was more than that. We discussed
As far as what those
So that's what I'm saying. So you got about a year, maybe sometimes a year and a half to do a grant. Am I right? To put the paperwork in.
Some.
Depends. Some are a year.
Yep.
So what I'm, that's why if you listen to what I said, you have to do priorities. Okay?
But where I was headed with this thing is a suggestion was made. Mm-hmm. You chose that you didn't want to fund it that way. That's your prerogative to do that. What I was seeing was grant opportunities coming because of my knowledge of grant and grant cycles,
right,
that we have at least two, if not three, that we'll even talk about tonight.
Right.
And I want to make doubly sure that we're all cool, as we talked about the last time.
Right.
If we're cool, I'm good.
Right.
But it comes back to the original comment, David, is you had a conversation around 4 hours, and you came up and you had a second conversation, and I was looking for a copy of that report. You promised me a copy of the report.
And I'm just telling you what the board told me.
Yeah.
We're not going to do it.
And we're not going to do it.
We had a good, solid discussion.
So
and so that's my answer to you.
And I will accept that. But I'm a little concerned that I was offered something, and now I'm not offered it, and just so we're clear.
Right. That's exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah. And I'm not happy with
position,
just to be perfectly frank.
That's fine. I'm not happy with a lot of things either.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you got to also figure out how many man hours do you want to. When this job started down there, it was only started at maybe 10 hours. And then they said, let's do grants. So now it got boosted to 15, 16.
Sure.
Now it's up to 20. Now you have an assistant down there. Now you want to go more.
You are chairman of the advisory board.
So you got to tell me when.
You want to save the taxpayers the tax rate. Right? You want to actually reduce the tax rate. Am I correct?
I want to we want to make sure what we're doing financially is we're doing it economically
but
and we're not constantly going like this and we're not getting anything back.
So are you suggesting that we're not getting anything back?
Oh, yeah. And we got plenty of adequate hours there.
Oh, again, your opinion.
I'll go along with that one this time.
And so where I'm headed is I have a concern. I'm a lot of concern, right?
What's your main concern is what I want to know.
Is that we don't boot the opportunity to do something with the community compact activities or Mass Works.
That's right. We don't want to lose any grants.
Right, because where I'm headed with that is Mass Works, at least, if we talk Quaybog Street, is $1 million deal.
Okay.
Right? Would we want the taxpayers
now, how
to
long
fund
do
that?
How long have you known about this grant, and how much time do we have to put it in?
About 6 weeks that we've known about it.
Okay.
Right? And certainly we have time.
And what's the deadline of putting this grant in?
I do not have that in front of me.
Okay, well, that's kind of key. That's key to this conversation.
But key to the conversation this evening is that, in fact, we employ a grant writer at no cost to the town, by the way, and that the board later in the agenda needs to, in fact, agree that they want to solicit that help. And so this is one of the early steps.
Good.
Should we be able to go get that consultant, guess what? We'd be saving some of Cindy's time, fortunately. However, she'd have to get them started.
Right.
So that's where we are. So it's a big deal.
Yeah.
Right? And I don't want to boot it.
Well, I don't either. So what's your point to
this discussion is really getting nowhere.
So right. What's your point, Clemens?
Okay.
Well, I guess my original point is I thought I was getting a study tonight, and I'm not.
That's right.
Right.
I just explained why, and I gave you the whole spell out.
Thanks.
It's pretty clear.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Now I'm going to go pack myself out in the audience.
Good deal.
Anybody else wish to address the board this evening?
Hearing nobody. Item number one, status on delinquent properties. So Mr. Snyder had requested, based on one inquiry for a property.
We each have copies in
there,
by the way.
Oh, well,
Mr. Snyder already has his.
Okay. Yeah, I have mine. Yep.
Unfortunately, that property, once it is taken, has to be held by the town for a year for them to pay off, so I think the issue is moot on that.
Well, I think it's the larger subject. The larger subject was abandoned property went before town meeting. Town meeting chose that we were not to pursue.
That's incorrect. My opinion on town meeting was that they voted to pass over that.
You are correct.
I.e., we can do whatever we want to. It doesn't tie our hands. The story of the abandoned property, I don't know if you've been contacted, but the residents that were soliciting moving forward with that ran against the barrier of the Board of Health coming to find out, the Board of Health has to sign off on everything with the Attorney General. They're unwilling to participate in the project, so they've stopped, which means if our Board of Health isn't willing to participate in it, we as Selectmen can't do anything, so we've stopped.
Yeah, and maybe I cut to the chase, I apologize.
But it wasn't the town. The town basically allowed us to do it, and I had concern with that. I actually spoke with the moderator saying I didn't think the town understood what they were voting on.
Oh, I don't think they did.
No.
So what we did, and this is some meetings ago, we had the rack and stack of different properties and different approaches to address different, I'd use the term delinquent in my request for this.
I.e. taxes?
Taxes, as an example. And so we had another meeting where it talked about how much we are delinquent in those taxes. And so that where I was headed with this request was kind of, what's the timeline? What's the clock? Let's make sure we understand what the clock is so that we can be clear with the residents and voters that, in fact, there are properties, we are taking actions. And again, this just provides the time and date as to when we can take the next action. That one particular set of calls, this was related to the citizen article where I said that I'm not going to stop. And so I did receive 3 telephone calls on a specific property, and now I have the information as to what the clock is as far as when it runs out, and therefore we can then inform the residents, the neighbors, that in fact that's what the clock is, and I will be doing that, is to respond back to them. And again, thank you, Karen, for putting this together with Sandy so that we can actually kind of know what the time frame is for the different ones.
Yeah. Okay. And from what Sandy has said, you've had the conversation with her as well. I had it with her last week.
Yeah, she discussed it with me.
Yep, so good. And again, it provides us kind of what the clock is and what we can do. I guess the first couple there, we get some 2013 dates. So again, at some convenience, I'd like to understand if we're talking 2013 and there was some, should in fact that first one, for example, be dropped from the list. If they're paying
everything that she stated to me, everything but the low value properties has been sent over to KP.
Well, I just
and without even the taking of the title, she's actually recouped almost $80,000 from the taxpayers.
It's all good
through payment plans.
She's doing good.
Well, that's why I say the first one, the guy started to pay, so it's a matter of whether or not that should remain on the list.
She's collected a lot of money this past.
Yeah, she's doing a good job.
Yep.
We good for one?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to pass over item number 2. Item number 3, just hold that out for there. There's a request to use the town roads for a 5K run. I'm assuming that's why you're here, Ms. Holm?
Yep.
Would you like to speak to it, or would you just like to let us approve it? Or? Did you guys see this? It's going to happen on the day of the Apple Country Fair. Mm-hmm. They haven't determined a location for starting point, but it is around this area.
Okay.
5K, approximately 30 runners, and the chief of police has already agreed with the safety measures.
What time would you be starting the race?
8:00.
8, okay.
Time to get coffee. When you get back.
That's what they're running for.
Exactly.
So I'll entertain a motion to allow the use for a 5K run on 10/8/2016.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Any further discussion?
No.
None all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And Kenny will promise to park his tractors.
All right. We were item number 4, we were actually short for payroll because of the leap year and the accounting at the town meeting. So Karen was very gracious to come to my office in Sturbridge because I could not leave to allow me to sign these, which were advised that I could legally. And I'm going to entertain a motion to ratify that signature. And the advisory committee has approved it as well for the water department for the amount of $55.90 for the clerk's salary, from the clerk's salary to water operator.
Mm-hmm.
$654.51 to the administrative assistant salary from the superintendent's salary. $522.29 to the administrative assistant salary from the selectman's expense. $470.25 from the ACO to the ACO's salary from the animal inspector. Do I have a motion?
I'll make
to ratify
the motion.
Signatures. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. These are all copies. Do you want them to sign the copies, or do you have an original?
I believe that the original. You know what happened, Dave? What happened is that you gave me back. You signed the copies. Remember when I gave them to you? I put sticky notes on all the originals. There were pink sticky notes, but when they came back to me, it was received a copy. So, do you have the original somewhere?
If I have a file
cabinet. Right. So, can you just hold on to that? They can sign that once we get the originals.
Yeah, go look for them. Would have the sticky notes on.
Yeah. Right. They took this up, the advisory committee took this up yesterday. Entertain a motion to approve a transfer of funds, municipal transfer, relief transfer from the fiscal year 16 fire wages to the fiscal 16 fire expense. After the transfer from the reserve fund, there was a failure with one of the garage doors. There are not enough funds in the expense account to cover the attached invoice.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. You come to reserve fund? The reserve fund transfer, it's the same thing with what I got from the advisory committee.
It's copies. All right, item number five. It was just two, correct?
Yeah.
They voted to approve this last night. There are no signature lines here. I'm just going to sign it as chair if we approve it. Amount request, so I'll entertain a motion for the amount of $1.49 to be transferred to the Central Mass Regional Planning Commission from the reserve fund. We unfortunately under budgeted by $1.49 when we got the bill. So we
got to pay the bill. Okay.
Yeah. So I'll entertain said motion.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Entertain a motion to approve a reserve fund transfer for the amount of $4,797. What account's going to, Karen?
It's going to general insurance.
General insurance, and it's the increase in mega. So again, the shortfall. So entertain said motion.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
No. Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
If you need originals, just let me know. I can sign those. Item number six, I would really like to table this. There is no review from the personnel board.
No.
In practice, we've never signed it, and it's policy that we don't sign until the personnel board. They have to get paid. It's wages. They're going to get paid, so it's not like we're shorting them anything.
I had looked at those earlier today, and Karen had said those were just a 3% increase on those.
I'd like to have it vetted by the personnel board. You guys are meeting tomorrow, aren't you? No?
I think it's next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday. They're still going to get paid.
Oh, sure.
I just like
they're
to
gonna be paid.
Stay
that's
with policy.
Yeah. Good.
So I want to table that. Item number seven, request for two that's out of order. Someone was messing with my folder. Item number seven, vacation carryovers. Officer Marino is requesting to carry over his two remaining unused vacation days to fiscal year 17. Entertain said motion.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Clark is requesting a carryover of 18 hours. The time was to be used by July 1st, but call-outs did not allow me, so I entertain a motion to allow him to carry over the 18 vacation hours.
I'll make
hours.
That motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Number eight. I don't know if you guys were in the loop on this.
Yeah, I saw that.
I weighed in via Karen through emails because I was unable to, for some reason I can only email from my house. Mm-hmm. I have no idea. Larry couldn't help me. Tantasco couldn't help me. Mr. Correa is requesting that the assistant, the alternate building inspector, do the inspections. I'm dead set against that. We have a building inspector. He's very unbiased. He's going to do his job. He has reached out to the state
building inspector as well. He would like him on site for a witness, and he's,
oh,
willing,
doing it together.
He's willing to do that as well.
Yeah, if they're doing it together, yeah, that's good.
You mean the assistant or
the state's?
It's just state alone is going to do it.
No, our building inspector is
going to. Yes, okay,
do
I agree. I think he should be down there. Yeah.
But he's being assisted.
He's being assisted.
He doesn't need assistance, in my opinion. No. He's just covering himself as a witness.
But you can put it that way as well.
I look at this as everyone in this room, yeah, I think, except our new visitor, and thank you very much for joining us, knows that I'm extremely blunt, unfortunately, yeah, to a fault. But it's based on fact and how I feel. This is extremely offensive, not only to the town of Brookfield, but to Mr. Taylor. I think his attorney and the careers owe Mr. Taylor. A huge
Mr.
apology.
Taylor does an excellent job, yep, and I don't know why they think they need to have an alternate down there.
So there's no need to act on this. Just we agree that Mr. Taylor is going to do the inspection. All right, number 9, policy issuing licenses.
There's no packet for that.
We already have.
We discussed. I was in the selectman's office last week.
We already had a bylaw on this.
Well, our tax collector came in and was had a concern in regards to our town clerk issuing licenses to people that shouldn't get licenses because the taxes were owed. I know there's a procedure for building permits. They have to get the tax collector's signature to make sure that
what
they're good.
What kind
there.
Of a license was this?
I think it was business licenses, right. So through the town clerk.
I know when I was town clerk, we had started discussing that. And, you know, if the taxes weren't paid, then they shouldn't have gotten any kind of a license.
According to her, people were getting licenses that have outstanding taxes.
They shouldn't be. They shouldn't get any kind of a license.
The problem that I have with this, and I told her, is that she's elected and our town clerk's elected. Mm-hmm. We have no say in either positions. Policies are great to have, but we can't tell them to follow them.
What I would always do when I was town clerk, I would issue that person the license for their business. It's what it does, it basically just registers their name. But I would always send a copy of that over to the zoning enforcement officer, and I would give them the zoning enforcement officer's number so that they could check with him to make sure that they're legally doing it in that.
So I have a problem with that. If they have a license, they're walking out of there thinking that they are legal.
No, I would always stress to them that before.
If I have a license in my hand, I walk out that door, I'm legal.
Nope. Yeah, well, and if I look at the couple of things that we have contention on at the moment, it's almost like they ought to walk into the planning board's meeting and say, this is the business that I'm about to do. Mm-hmm. Are we all good with the way we're approaching it? Because at least in now 3 instances,
it's becoming a free-for-all in the town of Brookfield.
We can't do that.
That we have to deal with.
Yeah.
And we look bad because we're telling people no, because it's not
later.
Correct.
I mean, here are people buying property and later on being told you can't do something that they thought that they could do. So I think it's a larger issue than issuing permits.
They should be checking first, I think, with the zoning enforcement officer and the planning board to make sure that they can do business in that district.
And that practice. Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
I got a phone call today from a circuit rider, and she wants one of us to run out to Town Farm Road because she has a client that wants to buy a piece of property on Town Farm Road and wants to find out what the deal is, where you have to go, what you have to do. I tried to explain to her on the phone. She says, why don't we meet down there? She says, well, I don't get paid for this, but I'll go down. And this is what's the problem. This is like 4 in town. They jump it back and forth, and then they start making accusations, which isn't fair.
So how do we do this? This is a good one.
We face this with the assessors. We face it with every elected position.
Well, what we're from the town clerk's office is, it's a business certificate. And what it does, it just registers that business in case somebody comes, say if the person is doing business and somebody calls up and wants to know if they're a registered business here in the community.
I'll tell you what.
That's what I
own a business in several towns. Mm-hmm. The town of Spencer. The town of Sturbridge doesn't make me do it. They'll make me get the business license, but it's Leslie just makes me pay the fee and I'm done. Spencer makes me get the sheet and get my sign-offs.
Okay. Maybe that's a practice we should start doing here.
Who issues the
town clerk issues the business license?
The business license. What it does, it just registers the business.
Yeah. No, I was just going a little bit on where Steve was headed. Okay. My question was, you get a form that you need to have certain checkoffs.
Just so, like a billing.
Yeah, like the billing.
Yeah. Well, I'm getting it, yeah. So that's good. So I was just curious as to who that individual was, and you're saying that's the clerk.
The town clerk gives me the form. It's my onus to go to the tax collector and make sure the taxes on the property are paid.
Taxes? Okay. How about the idea of a business purpose?
I don't know if I had to go. I had to get a building permit for the last one in Spencer because I changed locations. The first one was just, I think I might have, I had to sign off on fire, building inspector. It wasn't within conservation, so I didn't have to deal with conservation.
Would you have had to deal with planning? Because again, our three instances are planning related.
It was zoned, and you have to put on the form where the zoning.
Yeah, okay. If it's
all right, so that covers
Sharon,
that.
Sharon, did you have something to say?
If I can shed some light on this.
Yeah, good.
Sharon Mahoney, Chair of Planning Board, among other things. We had a discussion about this because, as Clarence has said, we've had three instances where people got a business permit from the town clerk and did not realize that they either had to get a special permit to operate said business or were not zoned at all for that business. We floated the idea in previous meetings, the planning board that is, of having a form much like you described and Steve you've mentioned in Spencer. We floated that idea past Jeff Taylor, the building inspector, and he said requiring people to sign such a form is illegal.
He makes, I'm dealing with a permit right now. He gave me a form that I have to get signed by.
Well, we wanted to get together with him and come up with the same type of form so that people would know where they need to go before they start a business. And he told us, one of the members who asked him, that such a form requiring people to sign it off is illegal.
Have you reached out to KP?
No, we've not.
That's a good thing.
I'd recommend reaching out to KP. So when I say KP, I've said it a couple of times, I'm trying to train myself. Have you gotten an email that they're no longer Copeland and Page?
It's KP Law now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. They've kept us on top of that.
Yeah.
So I would recommend that we reach out to KP. And to me, I don't think Mike would balk on pulling out a piece of paper and say, you got
to
deal with this.
We talked to Mike about this, and he's cooperative. He feels it's a good thing.
Yeah.
But again, we ran up against the brick wall, Jeff, because he said to one of our members who asked, this is not legal.
Can you reach out to KP? I don't see how Jeff is even involved in it, to be honest
with
you.
Jeff would be one of the signatures on it because he's the building inspector. I have an example of such a form that was in previous use in this town. It's pretty primitive. It's a dot matrix form on, the no carbon paper. But there was one at use in this town. And I showed it to Jeff. And he basically said, we can't do that anymore.
So Jeff's not an attorney, but Jeff is knowledgeable. He might have some talking points.
Yeah, but maybe there's a way that at least go talk to that person.
Are you willing to reach out to KP?
Yeah, it's going to take a hit in our budget, but sure, we'll do it.
I think you can put it under the Selectmen's budget if you want.
Okay.
Yes. But see, my agreement, when I used to do them, it was always with the zoning enforcement officer, and I told them before they started anything, they should check with the zoning enforcement officer.
The problem with that, Linda, is people hear what they want to hear.
So I don't think Jeff needs to sign off on it. I think Nick would have to sign off for us as a zoning enforcement officer.
Well, if it was strictly zoning, yes. But if we're talking about a comprehensive list of things people need to do before starting a business, and they were building as part of that business, so you would think that the building inspector would be part of that process.
So we keep the building inspector off, and he's his own entity for permits.
Well, what he's saying is we could not do that at all, regardless of his involvement. The idea, let me back up a bit. The idea that we talked about was a form that would cover all of the town bodies that possibly would need to sign off on a business. So that would, and they could come to us or the town clerk, and we could tell them which signatures they need.
That's just common sense. I did that with Ken a couple weeks ago. I'm nowhere near an issue with conservation, but he signed it regardless because there's a line on it.
And given that there is a form in the file that was in use previously, it was a practice before.
It's common sense. If you wanted to send an email to Karen and have Karen send it to KP so it comes through our budget, I'm not opposed to that. I don't think the other two selectmen are
opposed to it.
I see this as an excellent step. Yeah. I really do.
I thank Brenda for bringing it to my attention last week to get it on for discussion.
I should mention that part of this process that we talked about, in addition to a form, is providing information to the town clerk's office that he can hand to prospective business owners that
we talked about that a couple couple years ago as well, especially for building permits.
Right.
But Jeff does have a cheat sheet for that as well.
I was unaware of that. But we think that providing this information up front in the office where people would logically go would make a lot of sense because the zoning bylaws are very difficult to interpret.
We lucked out on one property. The homeowner moved. They received the business permit and an unzoned for food. And luckily they moved and we don't have to deal with that issue now.
Yeah, it would have been a fourth. Mm,
yeah.
And so, we've had two people come before us at planning board and maintain that because they got a business license, they were authorized to run
it. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Linda, you walk out the door. That's when
you look at... But I would always explain to them, it doesn't give them the right to
run business. Like I said, Linda, they hear what they want
to hear. When I'm given an estimate for a deck and I say it could be anywhere from 10,000 to 5,000, what number did you just hear? You just heard the 5,000. Right. And when it comes back at 10, 11,000, where'd this number come from? So.
But the practice that the former zoning enforcement officer and I had, it did work.
It's not working now.
It's obviously not working. Yeah, it's obviously not working. So
I will give you a testament. So I bought a piece of property, and I put a pretty huge barn on it, as you all know. And before I put a nickel down on that barn or that we were going to go forward with that, the planning board was very helpful before we bought the property and after we bought the property to make sure all the T's were crossed. And so, again, thank you for your support and your committee's support in the past, right? But I think it's very incumbent upon us as we look to grow the business sector.
We're very willing to answer questions in the context of a meeting.
When someone comes into that town clerk's office and has no idea, and nobody else has an idea, it's just a circle. It's a dog chasing
its
tail.
If they don't know to come before us, they won't get the answers they need. A form like this would provide some notice that they need to come before us or they don't need to come before us, depending on the project.
Simple email to KMP, I think, will resolve everything. And as long as Mike's on board, we're even better position.
Do you think it would be wise to include Mike in that email?
Yeah,
I think it would make sense.
It's exactly.
And Karen, you can talk to him before you send an email to KP. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I will copy the necessary party on that email.
Thank you. Ken?
Probably a good thing, maybe a billing sequence plan if you want to start a business in town and where you can have a business.
That's part of the discussion. So it'll be a sequence form. It could be just a double-sided page. Sequence form on the back and signature on the other side.
We have a lot of calls.
Keep it simple.
Yeah. A piece of land, what can I do with it?
The onus is on them to find out.
Yep. And in my case, by the way, the building inspector was very helpful.
He's extremely, he's not only helpful, he's knowledgeable, and that's what scares me because there's got to be some truth to the fact that...
Yeah. But there's got to be a workaround.
There's got to be someone.
Yeah, right.
Item number 10, community compact, Mr. Snyder.
Yeah, you wanted some time to look at that, and
I did. This is the first time I've seen this packet.
Yeah, we're not going to make a decision tonight, but what
is
I would suggest
is this is it.
Oh, that's it.
The governor's program is to encourage cooperation, learning, best practice sharing, and the like, and this is that program. And so what we learned, we had a meeting with Central Mass Regional Planning the other day. One of the things that came out of it was that we really ought to be moving forward with what the town wishes to do under the community compact. Mm-hmm. We brainstormed a bit at that meeting as to what the different practices that we might want to share in. Energy, because we've been talking about energy, was one of those topics. The second topic was earlier, if you remember, Bruce was talking about getting the map of the water connections between the different abutting towns, and that he thought that that was important, as well as sharing of licenses, potential sharing of licenses. And a third piece is that we have a grant we're moving forward with the seniors, and whether or not a senior activity might be helpful. Anyway, long story short for tonight, the thought that I would, because energy and energy audits and whatnot are something that we're talking about, that might be a good area. An additional reason why that might be a good idea is Secretary Beaton, Energy Secretary, there weren't a lot of takers on energy. So there may be some additional dollars beyond the initial $140,000 or $50,000 that we might qualify for to be able to do activities. And my suggestion would be potentially windows in this building or doors or whatever, energy-related activities. So again,
so those are the good things. What are the bad things?
I don't think there's a bad thing here.
There's always a bad thing.
Well, then I want you to read it.
All right.
But I think that the other communities around us, North Brookfield, West Brookfield, they've moved forward with their activities. They haven't.
Sturbridge has a CPA, and we've learned that the town of Brookfield thinks that there's bad things involved with the CPA.
And
so.
I would today argue opposite, but we won't talk CPA tonight. We'll talk about
if you want to continue program. For me to read this, you won't, because if there's nothing wrong with this and there's nothing wrong with CPA, I'm done reading this.
No, read it. Right. I think it's worthwhile. And further, I think that...
But we have to sign on as a Board of Selectmen?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we do.
Okay.
We do.
Well, I'd like to have a copy of that, too.
Can you get a copy for Linda as well?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So, if we were to choose to go forward, I would say that this funds the energy activities that we're talking about.
Okay. So we'll table that for now. Okay. Thank you. Item number 11, CMRPC Mass Works Grant. Floor is yours again.
And so in this particular grant, we have been talking for a long time about a Mass Works grant focused on Quaybug Street.
Now, weren't we denied a grant for Quaybug
Street? Yeah, we were.
Is it the same?
And now this is going back at
it. Is it the same grant?
No, it'll be rewritten.
But it's the same grant.
Let's pray that it's pretty much the same. It's going to have to fall under the complete street stuff as well. So
matching, full 100%?
Full 100%. Could be $1 million. So here's the deal. With CMRPC getting some additional resources, and I don't know if you saw that in the mail or the press that they've gotten additional resources, we have access to one of their grant writers. And what this does is by us saying, please help us submit this grant, that they would have a resource for us to be able to do that grant. So that would be one less thing that Cindy would have to do.
Okay.
And one less thing that we can keep money in our grant writing account for.
Exactly. Okay. So again, we do have to vote that we express to CMRPC that, in fact, the selectmen support this activity.
The activity of applying for the Quaybug, the Mass Works grant. So I'll entertain a motion to advise CMRPC that the town of Brookfield is interested in working with them on the Mass Work grant application for Quaybug Street.
I'll make the motion.
No, I'll second it.
Any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Deadline is up for our town accountant applications. There are several new ones. Unfortunately, I don't know if you've had a chance to take a look at all of them.
You did. I skimmed.
Skimmed.
Yep.
I wasn't very unhappy that the one that I thought would be good is no good. I think you guys have seen it as well from what I've heard.
Is that the one I...
From Hardwick?
Yeah, right. I investigated with both towns, and they don't recommend it.
So we've got to do some more investigating.
I don't know if we need to do any more investigating or just start calling people in for an interview and get on with this. Well, you want to go out again?
No. I'm just, because there's like two or three others that are in the sack, and I'm just wondering, with what Linda did for the first one,
I'm not opposed to calling these four in and having an interview with them. During the day, during the night, just strictly, just all four of them.
Oh, okay.
We could weed out one, we could weed out two, we could weed out three, make a decision that night, call them back for second interviews.
The only thing I don't like about this is the employment's only held like...
Well, that's why I said do a little...
That's what I don't like about this one.
Well, the only reason why I'm not apprehensive about that is because it says temporary already, doesn't it?
Yes.
I can call Town of Leicester if you want, because I know people down there.
Well, we have to agree if we want to bring these four people in for an interview.
And this one?
I was just thinking another screen. I'm not opposed to bringing them in, but I just think we ought to have a screen.
What do you mean by screen?
Telephone call.
Oh, we're going to do our due diligence before we call these people in.
Yeah.
So you want to call before?
Well, I think that's the point.
Do you want Linda to do it? Do you want to do it? Before we take one at a time, I didn't like that practice.
Yeah.
I think one person...
Since Linda started it, it's almost the same questions that you asked on the first one would be the questions that you'd ask on the second. Mm-hmm. And then we would yield to you as far as whether you take the next step and bring them in.
Well, like with this one, though, we don't have anybody really to call on this one.
Well, then let's bring them in.
So I don't think we need a motion for it.
So what?
So you just reach out to those four references, compile a database for each individual.
Okay.
We can meet next week in the morning if you want to discuss what we want to do. How long do you think it'll take? A week, 2 weeks?
Oh, I can start calling over this week.
Okay, so let Karen know when you're ready. We'll schedule another meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that'd be best.
That'll be good. Yeah. Okay.
So I'm going to let you have those.
All right.
With this, the ones that are upside down, which what we're going to... If you guys, can you look at those other ones that are upside down? Make sure we don't want to add them to the mix.
I made two calls on this one today.
Yeah, I understand.
Just a cover letter.
Yep.
Scares me.
Yeah. And I don't think we'd want it. This one's from...
Oh, no. Well, the ones that are from 3,000 miles away, I don't think
no.
so.
Okay, I will start making some calls on these and get back to Karen and let her know.
Oh. Other?
Yep.
This is the email. This is the first time I skimmed it before the meeting. I haven't had access to email today. I guess this came today, 9:05 this morning. I've been straight out. He did go to the property. The thing that, I don't want to offend anybody, but our highway department's actually saying that this damage was caused by the moving of the house. Are you aware of that?
What are you talking about?
That limb on 16 East Main.
What?
There was a limb that fell, and there's a limb still in the tree. Was it a maple? That could potentially come down.
Is that the one that the tree was looked at?
Yeah.
I have nothing with the house now. This is an aged tree that broke off at the base. Had nothing to do with the house now. There was no problems, and it should have been. If that was the case, I'm sure it would have been brought before this point.
It was brought up today. That's the first time I heard about it today.
You know what's going on. It's more propaganda and more politics from the highway superintendent against me.
I
in the story, you go up the tree board, there's all the ash trees up there are dead.
I haven't looked at it. If he's saying it's from the base, moving a house isn't going to do it.
Yeah, it's at the base. It ran off the tree board. He even told me himself on the telephone.
My belief is that if it was done when the house was moved, they would have made us aware of it that day, or within that month at least.
Well, it's something that needs to get done. So is it on the tree list?
Well, this discussion has to be had because is it the onus on the person that moved the house, or is the onus on the town of Brookfield?
I haven't been up to look at what.
I'd say the tree warden needs to give us that.
He's not the one saying it. Cindy's the one saying it.
No, then the tree warden needs to make the call.
All right.
And I brought these dead trees up to the tree warden, Mr. Chairman, a year ago, and he was aware of the ash trees, that they were all dead, and they could possibly come down. And this one just came down maybe a week or so ago, and I called Karen first of the week or end of last week. It's not a limb, it's a whole tree. And it's hung up in another tree. When that limb lets go, it's going to go into the street. So, had nothing to do with the house. You can see where it rotted right off on the base.
So the estimate that he received was for $175 an hour, which covers a bucket truck, log truck, chipper, and a two-man crew. Will not exceed 4 hours for the particular case we're talking about. Why we even have to approve it, I have no idea. To me,
the
tree warden has that ability.
What I suggested was that we have one tree list that needs to get added to the tree list, and then with that, we have proper funds in the tree list. I mean, the only other controversy is whether the homeowner is responsible or not, but where I'm headed is that we prioritize the list to make sure we were getting the worst ones first.
And Mrs. Fendrick has that list.
And he has that list. It's shared with...
Well, you understand why this is coming to light is because the branch fell. I think the highway department moved it on the road, didn't they?
Do what?
The highway department moved the branch that fell.
No, it's not a branch.
Well, you moved it?
No, it's an ash tree.
But a branch fell, didn't it?
No branch fell.
I was told a branch fell.
No.
And there's still a branch hanging in the tree.
There's some dead trees on West Main.
It's what?
You told me it was hanging at a 45-degree angle.
Yes, that's okay. Okay, so there's a miscommunication. It's a whole ash tree.
All right.
And it's not going to take 4 hours to take it down. If you get a bucket truck, you have it down in an hour.
So why is this on top of priority versus the other 60 or 100 trees that we have in the town?
You asking me that question?
Yeah.
Because the whole tree is leaning on another branch of a tree. And when the weight of that branch lets go, this tree is going to go into the road.
So that's...
And the tree board knows that ash trees will he told me they explode when they...
But that's where he told me that something was bound up, a branch,
And he told me it could fall in an hour, it could fall in 10 years.
So, which
I'm going to argue is every other tree on this list.
Sure.
Is it in an area where it would take down wires and knock out power?
Every tree has the potential of taking down anything.
Yeah. The wires will be the side. The trees
So,
to me, that's not a priority.
So my recommendation was to refer it to Cindy to get one added to the list. What further complicates that is to who's responsible. So that, the tree warden should make that determination. And regardless, it's on the list. And what we need to do is to prioritize. And again, the advisory board sufficiently funded the tree list to get it taken care of. And so not only that, we have a routine in town as far as the use of a contractor, mm-hmm. and we ought to match this quote up against what that other contractor would do.
Unfortunately, with that other contractor, what I've been told is that he has another job, and he can only work on Saturdays.
So, but Steve, you got a second quote right there, and if that is cost effective for the town, then the highway superintendent ought to proceed.
Well, it's not the highway superintendent, it would be the tree warden.
The tree warden.
Which would technically take our highway department completely out of the process, which I don't think Herb would have an issue with.
No, not at all. But at the same time, we created a process, good, bad, or indifferent, that we have a list of priority trees, priority areas, and that we need to be working off on that list. That is the highway superintendent's responsibility.
For itemizing the list?
Itemizing the list, because the admin holds it, and we're feeding to it, both highway and mm-hmm. tree warden are feeding that list, and this list is our priorities.
So do you want me to reach out to the tree warden and ask him what his plans are?
I think, yes. Would you please just verify whose responsibility?
For?
The removal of the tree. The homeowner is suggesting mm-hmm. it's not his problem, it's the town's problem.
When I talked to Bill last week, he said it was on town land.
Then it needs to get added to the list, and we need to refer it to the highway to get working on the list. And if this happens to be, from a hazard perspective, higher on the mm-hmm. list, then it needs to get worked on. But again, I don't think that we should make that determination.
And unfortunately, the way that we have been working, I don't think we have that option anymore on Saturdays. I don't know if you got a phone. I think you might have gotten a phone call. I don't know if you had a conversation with Mr. Chafee, but I guess they started cutting that tree down the lake at 6 a.m.
Oh yeah, well, I get the homeowner,
which is unacceptable. You don't start at 6 a.m. with chainsaws
on a lake. I mean, they had to wake up sometime, Steve.
No, but I appreciate the joking gesture, but it's a little bit inappropriate.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
We chatted with at least two neighbors on that topic.
Can I clarify? I only call in the tree to let people. I'm not looking to get the tree cut. If you cut it, you cut it. I'm just telling you if the tree fell, and I was just letting you know there was a safety hazard there.
I'm glad we had this conversation, because I thought it was a huge.
If you don't cut it, that's fine. Yep. I'm just letting you know that.
We don't have a wire issue. It's leaning onto property. It's not a hazard. Well, it's a hazard because it could
come
down.
It's a hazard, and it needs to be on the list.
Which it will.
But if you come here and look at it, then I'm sure you'll say, hey, it should come down as soon as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
one other thing I want to make very clear here is the house move, if you're looking where the tree is, it's out in the woods, had nothing to do with the house move. With that. And if the house did hit it and make that happen at the base like that, the house would have come off the wheels.
I just heard about it this morning. I haven't had a chance. I will drive by.
I'll take a look.
That's just total propaganda.
Again,
Ken was there. He's a witness. He could tell you.
You drilled holes in the bottom of the base, didn't you, Ken?
No, I didn't have it working. I told her to buy one.
All right. So correspondence. I love these correspondence. This is the first time I've heard of it. He's stating that it's a Mr. Earl Bonnet, the chair of the Massachusetts ESGR. He stated that he had stopped by in June, was unable to talk to anybody, but he's asking for the Brookfield's town of Brookfield support. Statement of support for the Garden Reserve, company name, assuming would be the town of Brookfield. We recognize the Garden and the Reserve are essential to the strength of our nation and the well-being of our communities. In the highest American tradition, the patriotic men and women of the Garden Reserve serve voluntarily in an honorable and vital profession. They train to respond to their community and their country in time of need. They deserve the support of every segment of our society. If these volunteer forces are to continue to serve our nation, increased public understanding is required of the essential role of the Guard and Reserve in preserving our national security. Therefore, we join other employers in pledging that we fully recognize, honor, and enforce the uninformed Services Employment and Reemployment Rights Act, USERRA. Our managers and supervisors will have the tools they need to effectively manage those employees who serve in the Guard and Reserve. We appreciate the values, leaderships, and unique skills service members bring to the workforce and will encourage opportunities to hire guardsmen, reservists, and veterans. We will continually recognize and support our country's service members and their families in peace and crisis and in war. I would entertain a motion right now, but for that first bullet, it places onus on the town to follow the USERRA. I'm unaware of what that states. Mm-hmm. So Karen, can you pull that up, mm-hmm. research what that is? You're talking to the son of a retired mm-hmm. captain in the U.S. Army Reserve, so this is very
former
easy.
Navy officer here.
Been Reserve there, done or, that. Yeah. Thank you. So this is near and dear to my heart.
Yep.
Yeah. National Guard right there, bang.
Yep.
Yankee Good Division. Stuff. So if we find that, we'll put it on the next agenda. Sure. I have no problem bringing this.
I don't have any problem with it either.
Any other comments on that?
Nope.
Any other issues before the board this evening? Yes, sir.
How many hours have you actually going to give this new town accountant? Is it 20 now?
We discussed it was under 20. I don't think we had a set number. I think we put in the budget for the...
We put the 20 in the budget.
The number that we have now, but obviously when we hire someone, it's going to be based on their experience.
Yeah.
You had that discussion 2 weeks ago. If you get someone who's going to run the books for the whole town and you don't give them some hours and some benefits, they're not going to stay with us.
I agree with you, Dave. I feel the same way.
And we're talking about all the finances.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 24 hours is, minimal. I mean, I think they can do it 24, but I don't know.
I'm going to argue we're doing it for less now, and she's doing a heck of a better job. So.
Right. But there's a lot of other
and
things.
And she's making the same exact pay.
So, I'm just saying that's kind of...
And then once we get a clerk in there with her, too, because we gave 15 hours for a clerk also.
We want to make sure, it's worthwhile for someone to take this job. So I guess that's my point.
I don't know if Linda's ever hired people. You've hired people, haven't you? I've hired people since 1990. I think we get it.
We have. We've been on the hire since I've been here.
I've sat in this seat and I've argued for a couple dollars because people weren't worth it, and I'm going to continue to do it. Mm-hmm. We're going to pay the person.
I'm the same way, but I'm just saying.
We're going to pay them what they're worth.
We get somebody that's going to stay.
That's our goal.
Yep, that's the goal.
But we don't have a crystal ball, and we can't chain them
desk. That's why I'm asking how many hours it's offset.
Any other issues?
Yes.
There is?
It's time. Well, it's time? Just if it's time. If there's time.
Clobbering time.
I know. It's getting close. Mass Historical, related to Town Hall. Correspondence that, in fact, because this is a historic building, mm-hmm. they do have some rights as far as moving forward with different projects. And so there are those things that are considered to be minor, mm-hmm. and that they would just, other than considering them minor.
So before you go forward.
Keep going.
I had an email from the assessor, Mr. Jones. I met with him last week. He likes the idea of relocating the assessor's office.
Okay.
I love the idea because it does
what you want.
Yeah.
It obviously does what we want, but we don't have to cut this room up.
Yeah, that's
even better.
I'm looking at myself as a GC in this, and it's a heck of a lot easier for me to organize that project than a new project over here.
Mm-hmm.
I met with the advisory committee last night. I think every single member was on board with it.
Okay.
Talking about relocating them to where we were originally. Yeah. If we're on board with it, I might move in that direction, and I think the town lets us do that. And the only really issue that we had was the urinals by one resident, and that would alleviate that. It would be the woman's room.
Right.
So it would be all the future woman's room. It would just be a bathroom, handicap accessible bathroom right now, but it wouldn't have any urinals, and it'd be all toilets.
Good. So we're complementing one another with this activity.
But my point of bringing this up is that it takes that major project of reframing this structure here into a minor project of something that's already up.
Yeah, exactly. So here's a recommendation suggestion because of Mass Historical. I did reach out to Paul Holtz, who I work with mm-hmm. from Mass Historical and the yeah. church, so I know him. He is available. He has meetings in Central Mass, Western Mass in a couple of weeks, and would stop by. And what I would recommend is that we maintain Bill Simpson as our local project coordinator, as he did the he was that person for the initial planning grant for the town hall. And so we would continue that, where what we would do is, between Bill and I, we would be working with Paul to what is the process to go through, and to suggest to him that we have this minor activity that we're looking in phase one.
I'm not knee-jerk. I saw that email. I didn't want to bring it up tonight because I didn't have time to wrap my head around it. If we okay. want to bring it up tonight.
Oh, we'll get 3 weeks.
I don't like the idea of bringing outside into this project yet, because it just makes it bigger than what it needs.
Yeah.
I think you have the knowledge. You as a selectman would look into the overall process of getting this whole building done. You can use Bill as an assistant. I'm not comfortable with putting titles out there. I want this to be managed. I just don't want too many chefs in the kitchen making too many phone calls and nothing coordinated.
No, that's why we're having a conversation.
In regards to the bathrooms, this is my project. If I'm not going to be in charge of it, I'm just going to walk away from it, because I've been on too many jobs where there's too many chefs in the kitchen.
Totally misinterpreting my approach.
This is, like I said, I didn't have enough time to really think about it. But knee jerk right now.
I just want to. Here's how this wants to. This is grant strategy.
Yep.
And again, as earlier conversation went, had a little practice in grant strategy to make sure you get the end game.
That's
the
why
end,
I think yeah. you need to be that lead. And if you wanted to use Bill as an asset, and this,
and
you know,
all I hey, quite honestly, Steve, the only thing that I want to do is that he was the local project coordinator of the original grant. He's the one who has the study in his hand. That he would join me in a meeting with this guy.
Oh, 100%. I don't think we need a discussion for that.
No.
I think everybody's on board that.
Okay, if you're cool,
we need Bill's buy-in.
Yeah, and it's more of that the phase one activity is a minor activity. But oh, by the way, speaking of grant cycles, February 2017, we have the opportunity to go for a big chunk, and it's a lot bigger than the phase one that we're funding. What I would like to do is have a strategy where we get credit for the phase one activity as far as matching money.
Again. Now, when you talk phase one, we're just talking the bathroom?
Yeah, well, ADA.
Actually, it was the ADA issue. That was it.
Yeah, ADA, and because we...
Which was the bathroom thresholds, door, 50,
the 50, phase one is $50,000 on that study.
Well, there's, yeah, okay. Yeah.
All right, so it's the same $50,000.
Mm-hmm. But that was just to widen the door.
And that's because you're a good project manager. So
easy.
All right, so what we do is we get, what I would like to try to do is capitalize on the $50,000 as matching money, and how to approach that, so that in the February 2017 thing, when we're looking for $900,000, that they, Mass Historical, might in fact fund 50% of that.
Well, it's an even better strategy because we've already allocated the money and we're up on the,
So I would like to sit with Paul when he's on his way to Western Mass. Here's the town hall. Here's how we would like to approach this project. And oh, by the way, Paul, you got this grant cycle in February 17. We'd like to apply for it. This is how we would like to apply for it. Can you assist us? And having them given us a planning grant originally, it puts us in favorable light, let's put. And I would like to build on that favorable light. Okay? If you're cool with it, that I just...
I'm going to tell you right now, my assumption is that was the path we were already on.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure we're in agreement.
Yeah.
Good.
Anything else?
Nope, that was... Oh, and Karen, we have not seen Mass Historical contract for the campground. Okay, so it's being mailed, so Steve, this is something you need to sign once the original gets here, so hopefully I'll find... They said they were mailing them, so I just...
We already voted on it, it's all good.
Yeah, it's just the formality when it gets here. Okay. Yep,
right, thanks. So I will entertain a motion to enter executive session number 3. To discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation, if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigating position of a public body, and the chair so declares, to enter back into open for the sole purpose of adjournment.
I'll make the motion.
No, second.
Come to our eye.
Lincoln, aye.
Snyder, aye.
Thank you, everyone.